it feels to me like there's a growing radical left movement within the Black community. And I'm wondering, is there more, I guess, awareness of like radical leftist politics? Are there more people talking about them?
Yeah, I feel like people are starting to become more radical, but it's not, I feel like people, they're starting small, kind of like the liberal stuff with like defund the police and all this, like they're finally starting to open their eyes. But I feel like as communists, we need to start being like, taking it up a little bit, being like, yeah, like right now things, it doesn't have to be this way, you know? We can have a society that's not built on racism. Oh wait, and there's something I like to do, if you don't know where to start on that, is like a lot of people like the Black Panthers. Like when you mentioned the Black Panthers, you're just like, oh yeah, everybody thought they were cool, but nobody knew that the Black Panthers were communists. But then when you mentioned like, oh yeah, the Black Panthers, they were communists, and you're like, for real? And then you start to learn more about the Black Panthers and the stuff that they believe. And that's how they like slowly start to become radical.
They were so effective that the federal government had to viciously dismantle them. You know, like I think they probably put more fear into the people in power than perhaps any other group in history in the USA. So that's definitely a good starting point, you know, for looking for looking to the past for solutions.
Generally, anti-capitalism is in. People see the flaws of capitalism already. There are a few people who are kind of annoyingly staunch, like loving the markets, capitalism made your phone, that sort of thing. But I mean, people generally, I would say, lean anti-capitalist, especially as we see its failures in the COVID response, as we see people struggling to eat, as we see people struggling to keep a roof over their heads, as we see the damage of the climate. And that's the biggest thing I would say. That's for the youth, because we see that, you know, our future is in jeopardy. We're now starting to live, and, you know, we grew up on, like, Sabumafu with the Krat brothers or whatever. So we know that, like, animals and plants or whatever are important. And we've grown up with this idea that, oh, you know, you just need to take care of the earth and whatever. And then we grew up and realize, okay, but none of the adults doing anything about it. Like, we have, what, 10 years left? Nothing's really being done about it. So people, and then people also going out and realizing, like, there aren't any jobs, you know. They say go to college. I mean, college is subsidized here, but, you know, they say go to college and get a job or whatever. And there aren't really any jobs, and they're asking for 5 years of experience for an entry-level job. And it's very difficult. A lot of people end up, you know, very alienated by the whole system. But I would say that people don't have the alternatives yet. Like, people see the problem with capitalism. People are anti-capitalist, from what I've seen. But all of that is just, like, if I tap through, like, my people I follow, like, their stories or whatever, or their tweets or whatever, it's like, capitalism sucks, this and the other, for this reason, that reason, and pointing out the different flaws with capitalism. But nobody's really pushing the alternatives. You know, nobody's pushing anarchism or socialism or communism or Leninism or anything like that. And then we also have to deal with the, and I'm saying it again, sort of colonial influence with the social conservatism. And that sort of lends itself to people being kind of passive, which is difficult to deal with. But we're looking to invigorate the youth, and I see a lot of potential there.
You are so incredibly spot on. Like, everything that has been said thus far very much plays into what I'm about to say. Levi mentioned that the Black Panthers were communists and socialists and fell into different denominations. Some were Maoists, some were straight up communists, some were internationalist socialists, some were libertarian socialists. Some, like one of the people I've studied, Kumbaya Erwin, is an anarchist. We know that the Black Panthers existed. We know that they were to be respected. We don't know that the Black Panthers were socialists. We do not know it. It is so, all of our figures, all of Black America's most powerful and looming contemporary figures were socialists to some degree, whether it was King or Baldwin or Shakur or Newton or Hampton or Elhaj Malik El-Shabazz himself, Kwame Ture, all of them were some manner of socialist. but we do not know it because it was very intentionally scrubbed from our history. You know, we tend to talk about manufacturing consent when we're in our leftist circles, but I really don't think anybody on the left truly comprehends the level of manufacturing consent that was placed upon the Black community. I mean, if you listen to certain interviews with former members of the Weathermen, the leftist extremist group that blew up buildings and stuff, they fully believed in revolution. It was not like, yeah, we believe that there can be a revolution. No, they saw the end of America. They were waiting for it. They were actively instigating it. They completely believed, specifically because of actions like the groups of the Black Panthers and Fred Hampton's Rainbow Coalition, they specifically believed America could fall tomorrow. America could crumble. Mm-hmm. And I really need everybody to consider just what happened in the 80s and 90s afterwards. Because you get the crack cocaine epidemic, you get the war on drugs, suddenly the music industry has dropped so many different prominent labels, gangster rap comes into the fold, and I think about this a lot. It was brought up by the late, great Kwame Ture, and my family actually knew the man, and specifically he talks about how King's greatest thing that he ever did for Black people wasn't, you know, giving them the gift of nonviolent action. It was teaching them to be fearless and stoic. King's idea of nonviolence as a political tactic was genius, because the moment the camera started rolling, the moment the media starts seeing all these people who have been relegated to the point of doghood, or they're animals, or they're no good, or, you know, those low-down dirty Negroes over in America or whatever, and they see these noble people fighting tyranny on the face of a bridge, being eaten alive by dogs and beaten to death by police, their children getting hosed down the street with water cannons, and looking in the face of death and laughing and saying, God is with us and y'all ain't shit. We're gonna get y'all. That changed everything. That completely changed the dynamic. There was such a noble sort of appearance of the Black individual from America after King. And the most devastating thing I think the FBI and the CIA and America in general ever did was completely dedicate 2 decades to destroying it. They obliterated it. They were so terrified, because that whole title of Judas and the Black Messiah is 100% accurate. Like, seriously. As far as the FBI was concerned, Hampton was about to bring America to its death knell. He was, you know, the Seraph's trumpet. It was over if Black America actually got that far, because we were essentially the epicenter. You know, we're constantly set as the trendsetters, we're the culture setters. We make a new word to add to the dictionary every other goddamn month. And people were willing to follow that. They were willing to follow this next episode of history. And so I feel like it is greatly played down just how much liberal media will 100% destroy you once you actually become a threat to capital. Once you actually become a legitimate, substantial threat to capital, you are the greatest danger America has ever seen. You're the USSR. You are no longer human. And, you know, so many of our leaders have that history, and it is very intentional that none of us know it. Did you know that Samuel Jackson was once a member of the Panther Party?
I did not know that, really.
I didn't know that shit. I found out like a year ago.
The FBI showed up to his mom's house and
that's how he went to LA.
Yeah.
Wow, really? Yes. See, that's totally like lost history. I had no clue.
There's an incredible amount of lost history about people in our communities, about the people who have fought for us, who have served us, who have gotten like half the goddamn civil rights that anybody in America has access to.
Just really touching on the liberal recuperation, the capitalist recuperation of the radical Black movement in history. I like to say there are two versions of Dr. King. There's the Dr. King who lived and breathed, and then there's this like capitalist kind of Frankenstein version of Dr. King, where they've really watered it down to like make the civil rights movement of the 60s like look more sanitized. There's a podcast about the history of black capitalism. It was an episode of 99% Invisible, I believe. And they were talking about the history of McDonald's in the black community. McDonald's was really big on pushing Martin Luther King Day because McDonald's was trying to like move more McDonald's stores into the black communities. And they developed a lot of educational material, actually. So they would make like I don't know if they were pamphlets or like VHS tapes or something to go into, put into schools about Dr. King. And so like even McDonald's had a role to play in the sanitization and like bowdlerization of the history of Dr. King. And, you know, that was all happening like in the 80s and the early 90s, because originally Martin Luther King Day was going to be very controversial. A lot of white people didn't want to have an MLK Day because they saw him as a very radical, divisive black figure, you know, like a radical socialist kind of figure. And so like it took years and years, like decades to sanitize the history of Dr. King enough to where now everybody sees him as like this total like liberal, but he wasn't. So I think that's really, you know, important that we go back and learn the real history of these things, including, you know, and also the Black Panthers and I guess Samuel Jackson as well.
It's so much, and it is so very deliberately sort of painted as, you know, I'm probably going to upset somebody when I say this, but when I found out that John Lewis died, I did not mourn because I knew what Kwame Ture had said about John Lewis. I knew what he had done back in the SNCC days, how he completely sold out the organization to the Democrats, how he took all the cred that was being built up by SNCC and the activists down there who were getting people to sign up for their voting rights, and then went back to them behind the back of the entire organization and said, vote for the Democrats. Meanwhile, everybody else was trying to establish their own independent political party. It's very much a part of this history where we're taught to worship the liberals. The liberals are doing the right things. The liberals are on the right side of history. Vote for Joe Biden because he's not the worst man in the world. Also, earlier today, he said that black people are essentially a monolith and aren't as diverse as Latino people. Or that time he said, like, you know, poor kids are just as good as white kids. Or, you know, the fact that he's a literal segregationist. Like, the war on drugs, the war on crime. My mama remembers that motherfucker real well.